Blackstone presents Reaching 90 by Martin Duberman. This book is read by Donald Corren. For Eli. I think we are well advised to keep on nodding terms with the people we used to be, whether we find them attractive company or not. Otherwise, they turn up unannounced and surprise us, come hammering on the mine's door at 4 a.m. of a bad night and demand to know who deserted them, who betrayed them, who is going to make amends. Joan Didion, slouching towards Bethlehem. Consider what immense forces society brings to play on each of us, how that society changes from decade to decade, and also from class to class. Well, if we cannot analyze these invisible presences, we know very little of the subject of the memoir, and again how futile life writing becomes. I see myself as a fish in a stream, deflected, held in place, but cannot describe the stream. Virginia Woolf, Sketch of the Past. Part 1, 1930 to 1986. In the all-male high school I attended, the female roles in our theater productions were necessarily played by boys. I myself performed both male and female parts, usually side by side with my closest friend Bob Sandler. Our repertoire was no minor thing. I managed to inhabit roles as varied as glamorous stewardess, rugged seaman, and murderous old spinster. Bob and I were notorious for side-splitting fits of laughter, breaking up rehearsals over some innocuous line, stopping the scene in its tracks. It was a case of high spirits, not bottled up hysteria, and it didn't take much to set us off. We drove our delicate drama teacher to distraction. Once, in an uncontrollable rage, he slapped Bob hard across the face. That did subdue us, momentarily. I'd also get into occasional fits of hilarity with another friend, Eddie Bernstein, my co-star on our undefeated tennis team. When en route by car to play against another school, we'd be seized by gales of exuberant, rowdy laughter, which drove the coach, no less than the drama teacher, to distraction. He never slapped us, which, in retrospect, I suppose confirms that he was straight. Real men don't lose emotional control, and delineates the quite different effective boundaries separating sports and theater. In Sutton Vane's 1923 play Outward Bound, I played an alluring, enigmatic stewardess, she who mysteriously fends off the passengers' pestering questions about the ship's destination. They don't realize, you see, that they're dead and that their ocean liner is doomed to circle aimlessly through eternity. Only at the play's end does the stewardess finally reveal, in a thrillingly trashy line that I delivered with melodramatic flair, that we're bound for heaven, sir, and hell, too. They're the same place, you see. Post-performance, wrapped in applause at the triumphant verisimilitude of my leap across genders, I was oblivious to what may have been a dim view among some of the spectators at the apparent ease of my transformation. I myself, who now I'm told inhabit a casual masculinity, find my relaxed assumption of the stewardess role hard to credit. Yet the memory firmly holds, as does yet another that accompanies it. One night, when Bob Sandler and I were crossing the quad along with our dates to the scheduled post-performance dance in the school gym, Bob's girlfriend suddenly realized that I was the actress who'd played the stewardess. "But you can't be," she gasped. "You have such beautiful legs." Perhaps the moment remains vivid because it rudely confirmed the dawning awareness that, despite my high standing as a scholar-athlete, I was somehow different, and not enviably so. Yet I have no recall of how I processed the news, or if I even needed to. No stations of the cross traversed, no family rows or resolutions, no snide taunts from fellow students. I do recall that with the onset of adolescence, my mother suggested a few sessions with a psychotherapist. I'd grown quiet around the house, in stark contrast to my ebullience outside it, and she'd apparently become concerned about my withdrawal when at home, possibly connecting it to my deepening voice and sprouting whiskers. My mother's instincts were keen. My father, oppositely, opted for determined disengagement, and she may well have surmised that sexual arousal of the wrong kind was imminent. Certainly the psychiatrist made that assumption. I have a cloudy recollection of recounting a dream involving another man and me masturbating each other, after which the therapist confidently assured me that treatment could and would redirect my sexual energy to the appropriate gender. He was apparently an early acolyte of what would soon become known and later discredited as conversion therapy, which I'd like to believe was why I actively disliked him, and after a few more sessions refused to continue treatment. I embarked instead on my own conversion. I bought a set of dumbbells and started to work out in my room. Several classmates openly admired my burgeoning muscles. They suited well my next theatrical role, a seaman in Bound East for Cardiff, one of Eugene O'Neill's sea plays. It, too, had an indelible one-liner that, if no match for Sutton Vane's campy heaven or hell, sticks in my mind to this day. Mon, but it's clear out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.